Australia, Japan, and now in LA. It's pretty much what Chuck said. We try to bring like art and technology kind of together to make something new and interesting using the latest gadgets and cool stuff. And right now that's virtual reality. So I try to focus this talk on mostly the high-end VR, because all the low-end VR is kind of going to end up at that point. Like mobile will basically be the same as the high-end VR. It'll have hand tracking and positional tracking and all of that stuff. So that's kind of the, especially for design-focused thinking, that's kind of the target you want to aim for, because otherwise, you know, you're only relevant for a small slice of history, I guess. It's just some shiny animated stuff, the kind of like feeling we like to go for in our experimental stuff. This is the game we're working on now for HTC Vive, and I just want to use it as like a kind of example piece to show a lot of the, to sort of give context to a lot of the concepts that I'll talk about for VR specific design. But mostly the focus will be on comfort, and which is generally how to avoid discomfort in VR. You know, the largest one being motion sickness. Why is game dev relevant? Because 90% of the decisions in VR are made around performance. And the technology stack is pretty much the same. It's, you know, it's game engines that are making the next generation of VR experiences. And just in case anyone's not familiar, these are the main headsets for VR right now. You've got the original DK1 that kind of was a Kickstarter that started this whole wave of VR. Then you've got the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive, which are the two main high-end platforms. PSVR, which is somewhere in the middle, and the mobile Gear VR and Google Daydream. And the things that differentiate them are field of view, resolution, refresh rate, screen type, and the, you know, ergonomics, which the PSVR is generally regarded as the most comfortable, just the way the weight sits on the head. So the main feature that I think differentiates the high-end headsets and the low-end headsets right now is tracking. And the rotational tracking is prevalent in all the headsets, you know, because it's basically just JavaScript, the same as your phone. So it's pretty mature technology, and it's not as difficult. The positional tracking is the, you know, the lateral motion. It's not just the turning. And when you don't have both of these things, even when you try to turn your head subtly, you know, it's not picking up that lateral motion, and you kind of subconsciously that's the kind of stuff that makes you sick and that kind of doesn't make the VR feel as real as it could. And I think that's something that's very missing in mobile VR right now. But it will come, so you should focus on systems that do have it in solving design. This is the general graph of the landscape. So the HTC Vive and the Oculus are what I think is good to focus on right now for design. The limitations, the resolution of the headset, even though it's a, you know, an impressive like 1080p per eye headset, when you look at the size of the virtual display, that's the equivalent of having a monitor that's like something like 320 by 240. You know, at that range, that's the amount of pixels you have. So that's a huge limitation in how you want to display text or like show things or how much clarity you have when you're looking at faraway things. What else? Your sense of distance perception, because you still just really have a flat screen on your face, it's not quite the same the way the photons come to your eyes. So that creates a lot of problems related in your sense of depth in VR. And tracking obfuscations is just, we have external trackers for your motion in VR, so it's easy for that to get blocked. When you can't hear anything, you know, but you can't see anything. Limitations. There's no way to see the outside world from inside, which is more of a problem than you think it should be. There might be a speech practice game, you know, and you have a podium here, and like you go to lean on it, and it doesn't really exist. And people do this stuff, and they do it a lot. So that's something that's missing from VR right now, is any way to get the real world back in. Comfort. These are the main things that are like important to keep in mind on like every part of the design. And motion sickness is the biggest one. Eye strain is kind of a thing, but you know, for like faraway text and things that are not very clear, but it's not a huge problem. Ergonomics, it's not really your problem, but it's important to know about. People aren't really going to be comfortable right now having a headset on for like 3 hours because you get all sweaty, you know, especially in a very active game. So it's important to keep in mind reality interference, like things like that. And just general discomfort, you know. I think sweatiness is a big one, because, you know, people want to make sports games and lots of very exciting things, but those headsets get really sweaty. Motion sickness. The cause of motion sickness is your inner ear is feeling movement, but your vision is not seeing it, or the other way around. In a car, it's you're not feeling any movement, but you're seeing it. It's kind of the opposite way around to a car. So in a game, if you're moving in the game, in the real world you're stationary, your body's gonna think you're poison, and that'll make you want to throw up. And there's no hard scientific research, but it's somewhere in the range of, you know, 20% of people have no problem with this, 20% of people always have a problem with it, and everyone else is kind of in the middle. Either they can become accustomed to it, or some experiences are good and some are bad for them. So it has to be a really strong focal point in your design to make sure that moving someone in VR is not going to make them sick. And it's really important, yeah, because when we're demoing VR, half of the people come up to us and the first thing they ask is, will this make me sick? You know, and that's not really where you want to start for a new wave of consumer product, right? And so the primary cause of this is just moving people around in the virtual world. They're standing still in the real world, you're moving them around in the virtual world. And really, when we think about virtual worlds, 90% of the experiences you want to move around, you want to fly over mountains, you want to visit and travel places. So all the things we want to make involve moving, so we have to take care of this. There's a lot of ways to do it. This is a super interesting method where you kind of throw a thing and then you can look through from that place and then you're just kind of there. This is, you know, there's a lot of R&D that needs to be done in this space, but there's teleporting, there's moving around with the stick, climbing things, which feels much better than you think it would, swinging your arms to pretend to be walking, you know, just sliding fast or piloting cars. You can do things where you can subtly turn a corridor so that it's not perceptible. So you think you're walking in a straight line, but you're actually going around in a circle, which is fun. And there's some other techniques, if you have a very strong vignette while you're moving, it doesn't make as many people as sick. So there's still a lot of stuff that people are trying to figure this out, because, you know, we need a robust general solution and no one's really found it. So the best choice generally right now is teleporting, which is you just point where you want to go and you just appear there. But it's not satisfactory. So be prepared to kind of design your experiences around how people get around or whether you want them to be stationary. And yeah, if you have time and money, try and do some research and figure it out for everybody. Future solutions. I mean, one day we'll just stimulate our brain directly and we'll feel like we're moving. But, you know, there's some companies working on conveyor belts and things right now, but they're not going to be mass consumer products in the same way, so it's not super relevant, but, you know, installation places and arcades might find this kind of stuff useful, and they're kind of cool, I guess. Visuals. Text is really bad in VR, and a lot of things we want to do in VR right now involves text. And probably, you know, at least half of the ideas you have, the things you want to make, it can involve a lot of reading, but even like this kind of example, this text is unreadable. You know, you have to have a giant monitor, so, or a giant virtual monitor just to read some basic text, or have giant font. So that's something to keep in mind right now, but, you know, maybe in 2 or 3, 4 years that won't be such a huge problem. But it's not just text, you know, things that are the next table over in that picture, you won't be able to make out faces of people. It's really low res. There's no focal depth, so you have to use visual elements in the scene to give a sense of depth. It's your perception of these two lines, if you take away all the middle pieces, that's kind of what you're dealing with. And if you want to make the top yellow line seem really far away, if you don't have the train tracks, you know, you're not going to perceive it in the same way. That's kind of a bad explanation. Use this. So we kind of think about it from a design perspective of there's five interesting spaces to work with. The one is right around you, where you can touch things, you can read text. All the detail of the objects is very clear, and there's not really any problems with this space. The next one is immediately outside of that, kind of the circle just outside your arm's reach. So what we have here, this menu that you kind of place in space, but then you can't quite reach the buttons at the top. You know, so we have a pull mechanic that pulls it out. So I guess things in the close range is okay to touch, but anything beyond that immediately, you have to have a sort of remote control where you're interacting with it. Because otherwise people, if they're using VR on this stage and you put something just out of reach, that's, if it's close enough that they think they can just about get to it, they're gonna try and they're gonna fall. or they're gonna bump into a desk, or they're gonna bump into a wall. It's one of those things that brings the sort of limitations of VR, like kind of interferes with your experience, which is what you wanna avoid. Then in the middle space is kind of opening those tables there, where you can like throw things, you can shoot things, you can kind of see what's going on, but you probably wouldn't be able to recognize someone's expression very clearly with current headsets. It's just that low resolution. And you just don't have anything really important happening at that kind of range. But you have to use it to build a sense of distance and depth for the things going out from close to far. Kind of just that explanation. your sense of, if you have something that's far away that's supposed to be touched, people are going to feel confined. They're going to want to go over there so that they can interact with that thing. So try and always keep the things close by, the things that you want the player or the user to be touching, and keep the things that are far away that they want to look at but not interact with. And then they're going to be trapped in a very, very small physical space. It's like if you were trapped in a cubicle that was all around you, that would be, you know, it's not a very nice experience. So you have to sufficiently distract someone so to continuously entertain with the things that are immediately in their space, so they never feel that, like, I can go to the other side of the stage, but I don't need to, you know, that's kind of the feeling you want to avoid. Depth perception is really tricky and hard. In our game, we have some parts that work and some parts don't. It's kind of a black art of, like, you know, placing things, like, at the right distance to give that perspective. You know, in this example, it's like, if you're looking at a cube and the lighting is not correct in a pretty empty scene, you don't know if it's a small cube close to you or a big cube far away. That's essentially the problem. There's an example of one of our stages where you're standing on here and you're seeing things happen down here. And, you know, you can really only interact with like here, but it doesn't feel as far away as it actually is. So you tend to try and throw things over there. And you think it's going to land and just fall like right here. And so, you know, it's an ongoing problem. Interactions. Touching things in VR is weird because you'll pick something up and put it on a virtual table, but you go right through it. So really the only thing you can do right now is use haptics to kind of simulate interactions, collisions with objects. Even if you're going into a table, if the controllers are vibrating when you do that, you get a sense that it's real and solid. And you know, there's lots of research around on how haptics should feel, but you know, like buttons turning on and off, you can have it vibrate one way and then it vibrates down, you know, for the off version of it. It seems really subtle, but a game that has that and a game that doesn't have that feels, the quality level feels very different. You can also, you know, involve the real space in the haptics. So when you're measuring the play space for the Vive, you like grab it's kind of like pulling a measuring tape, and as you pull it in physical space, it makes like a tick vibrate, and it's a really uncanny feeling because it really feels like you're pulling an actual tape. It's not really a mechanic that many people have explored well. Performance is really important. If your game's not running fast, you're going to feel sick. Even if it's dropping frames occasionally, and it's not really perceptible, eventually you'll just start to feel sick. So always, always, always you have to think about performance. And on top of that, it's rendering a VR game is like four times rendering a normal game. You have at a higher frame rate and you have two screens basically. And the resolution of those screens is gonna go up as fast as, you know, as fast as we can go. So that's gonna be a larger problem in the future. It's hard. Look at game dev techniques and rebel optimization. Or, you know, look at how Nintendo does things on their very simple hardware, where they take a stylized and simple approach. So building your whole design around that kind of visual style. Can make things easier. Don't drop frames, ever. I don't know what that is. So it's kind of the general space of like things to avoid with, I don't know, not making people sick or uncomfortable in VR. It's mostly about the tech limitations, low resolution,
drop frames.
We found it's easy to like design to avoid the problems. Some of these problems are solvable with R&D, some of them are solvable with future technology, but right now it's the best choice is to probably just avoid like a head-on collision with these problems. And don't accept that motion sickness is okay, because I see that a lot. It's not. So just sort of like three quick examples of things you did and how it's, you know, what concepts are relevant for that particular design. This is using the Elite Motion hand sensor. And this guy playing is not using the VR headset, but you just put it on your head. And you know, this is actually 2D, we're just drawing like expanding circles. And it's a very abstract art style, and that takes away, even though you kind of know that you're moving through a tunnel, the fact that it's abstract, you don't really process it the same way you would for actual flying. So you don't really get motion sickness in the sense of moving. And just the scale is all, I don't know, it's not quite the same as real life, so none of your like, I guess like real world perception really turns. So that's one way to avoid the problem. It's a space puppy. It's one of our first experiments on the Vive. You know, we're on a very strict time budget, but there's no floor, there's no world other than this strange abstract thing. So you never have any sense of how far away things are. You just don't think about it all. So really, it's just one thing to focus on. So nothing can go wrong in terms of how the interactions work or whether they feel something is close or far. So just by distilling it down to like one thing, kind of eliminated having to really deal with like so many of the problems with VR, and it just works. So if you can do that on the design level, you know you can save months and months of work. The cosmic trip again, yeah, covered most of that, but generally, you know, interaction elements. We let the user bring up the menu, which means that we know that the hand can be in that space. You know, we tried a lot of things, like you build a building, and we used to have it so you could sort of press the top of it and like menu things would come out of it, but it was always kind of like slightly awkwardly out of reach or things would be in the way. But if you know that the user can open a menu in 3D space and it's not physical, then if they can open it there, then you know that they can interact with it. And everything else in the game outside of that will make it so you can kind of vacuum it in. So there's not really any failure states for interacting with objects. And that just took a lot of values to find. The other one is just the constant distraction from the fact that you're, in this game in particular, you're kind of building these buildings around you and you kind of wall yourself in, you know, and you don't want to have that feeling of confinement. So one of the things we do is everything is, this is kind of the highest of the buildings you build and go, so that, you know, you're never having your line of sight blocked, so that you feel trapped. And there's a way to jump from like area to area. So even though you're in this wide open desert area, you feel like you could walk around, you're constantly, your attention is taken for the things immediate in your space, or the faraway places that you can travel to that have something of interest to you. So it's a lot of psychology, I guess, and watching people play, see what they do, and find ways to distract them from doing things you don't want them to do, and encourage them to do things you want them to do. Is this our locomotion technique? We kind of pull up a thing and like teleport through it. And there's nothing super complicated about it, we just slide them there. But if you slow that down, that slide slightly, you get really motion sickness. If you keep it under 150 milliseconds or so, you don't get motion sickness. And there's some subtle things like we change all the colors, and also you're kind of taking a physical step. So the part of your brain that's like dealing with you physically moving and that mismatch is, you're kind of, I don't know, sidestepping the problem, I guess. So this is like one example of like just going deep on a problem and finding a custom solution that works for that, for our specific game. So I'd recommend doing that if you have time. Let's end it.
Thank you so much for doing that. So we're going to open this up to our Q&A now, and hold on, let's see if this works. I'll test that.
Hello.
So what we're going to do is I'm going to go around and ask a few hand the mic out to anybody that has questions. If you raise your hand, I'll come to you. So
thanks. Thank you so much. It was awesome. So I'm wondering about the combined physical movement stuff. If there are any options out there that you're, because I'm not super aware of the latest up and coming stuff in VR. So is there stuff out there for movement where, like you talked about, if people can take a step, that helps with motion sickness. Is that sufficiently impacting, like in preventing motion sickness, that there's something where like someone could take steps in place and it could move and it could kind of overcome that?
I think there is, for each case it's kind of different. For us, it's like when you take that step, as you step into the teleporter, by the time you arrive, just you're still kind of physically, like that motion is still kind of going on. And sometimes even you get a sense of, I'm moving, but then you've already arrived and then your brain's like, oh, never mind. So that's like for that specific case. But a lot of people seem to be having some success with the arm swinging. Like, you know, it's close enough to walking that just standing still and doing this, it has like a similar kind of rhythm. I think there's some mechanism of the brain that, I don't know, kind of hard to pin down exactly, but if you're mapping one physical motion onto like another in-game motion, I think the brain can adapt that well. So if you're, for example, stepping like left to right, even if in-game, you're moving at the same pace, but in one direction. I think that's something your brain could, some things like that your brain could maybe come to deal with better. It's kind of like, there's some other example, but it's like, if the shape of a curve is the same, but the magnitude is different, it's like your brain accepts it. That's kind of the general sense that I have, but that's not rigorous science.
Okay, thanks for the presentation. The question I have is, what can I do at home? What kind of hardware and software could I get to play with and develop ideas?
If you want to go for the cheaper end, hit up the Gear VR or the Google Daydream for mobile stuff. But, you know, the tracking is simple, but it's an easier place to start. The Oculus and HTC, I mean, both of them are really expensive. You need a pretty high-end PC to run it, and there's not really anywhere around it right now. But they have positional tracking, and they can kind of handle a room area. And then on the software side of things, just learn to use Unity or Unreal Engine. There's a mountain of tutorials and examples, and you know, there's a lot of people who went into development that want to get in specifically for VR. There's a lot of interest for content for how to get started. So it's all out there.
I have a question, actually. So this is great for VR headsets and VR technology, but we're also seeing now augmented reality headsets being produced. Particularly, there's one actually produced by Epson, and they created a transparent visor that is supposed to be part VR and part augmented reality. What are your thoughts about the integration of augmented reality into these new headsets and the technology and how we're going to move forward with these new VR techs?
I think at some point VR and AR will merge, and there will be no distinction. You know, you might just have like a slider for how much of the real world you want in, so you just turn it off and you're in virtual reality. You turn it back transparent. It's in AR, but I think in terms of like software design, AR is going to be a very different space. And I think like right now is a consumer level where you can really go and make like very complicated and interesting things for VR. And I think AR is maybe like 2 years behind on that sort of hardware curve. Like right now is the time to get prototype kits and make interesting like closed door demonstration products. Whereas for VR right now is the time to get started on like a mainstream consumer product that in a year from now will be sort of in place as it becomes more mainstream. So I think they'll merge, it's just AR is a bit harder. But the problems you have to solve for VR, you're still gonna have to solve in AR, you're just gonna have some more.
I have two questions for you. The first one is that I use PSVR from a friend, and they use this light laser tracking thing, right? And when I use it, I can do the
positional
tracking, right? And so I wonder how does the HTV and the Oculus Rift use the tracking, and how do they solve that problem?
So the PSVR, they have the PSI camera, and it sits on top or under the TV. You know, it has like a maybe 60-degree field of view, and so it can see the PSVR has lights on it, and the controllers that they have a big lit up ball on the end as well, and uses
right.
that. It takes the camera data and uses that to track where things are, which means that as you get further away, you know, the resolution is less and less, so its range is kind of limited. The Oculus has two cameras, but the PSI camera is like 9 years old or something now, so it's pretty impressive what they're doing, but it's not as high quality tracking as these two. The Oculus has two cameras that sits on your desk on each side, and you can add additional ones to kind of take up the whole 360 so that when you're facing away, you know, it can still see the controllers. And it just uses camera-based technology to track the controllers. I think these things have sensors that show up in the camera's infrared or whatever. It's newer, so it's much higher detail, but it can still have tracking issues sometimes. The HTC is probably the best tracking solution. You would mount them like on the corner of the wall, like where these speakers are, and they just have two spinning lasers that kind of broadcast beams at like 10,000 hertz. And the headset, like all of these are sensors for that. So these things are not connected to a PC, which means you can just have them running in a room, and you can have 10 people with their own vibe set up with their own PCs, and they just all, you know, all it needs is lasers in the room to figure out where it is. So it's a very scalable solution, and I think just shooting lasers like that is much more accurate tracking. And because they are on the corners of the room, it tends to be less cases where you're sort of hiding your controllers or your head from. You know, to hide the headset is very difficult from the tracking. Whereas if you have two cameras on your desk and you put a controller under the desk, like it's not visible anymore.
My name is Ed, and I have several things here I want to pull out here. First of all, are you trying to solve technical issues because you're competing against Microsoft and Google and a lot of those other efforts to do technical problems as opposed to maybe what your end game is to really develop material content for those things? Because once those things are solved, I mean, are you involved in trying to solve those problems or really in the content of it?
I mean, we just want to make cool stuff.
Yeah, so you're in the context, right?
And we, you know, some of the problem spaces we avoid and some we try to dig in and solve. And, you know, we have to make a custom solution for a lot of these problems because the interesting thing about working on VR right now is that for a lot of the problem spaces, nobody knows, and if a solution is starting to become common, it's not certain that it's the actual way to solve it. So there's a lot of space to just kind of wing it. That's kind of the style we enjoy, I guess.
So are you familiar with Tango,
yes.
Which is the way by which AR is really wrapped? I've been around virtual reality for a long time. I haven't been involved with it, but I've been around it. And Tango seems to be one of the efforts to kind of accelerate AR into the VR world. I mean, and if people don't know what Tango is, it's just a software program that some phones now have to be able to give you 3D mapping in real time.
Yeah. I don't know if there's a question, but like...
Well, yeah, so are you involved with Tango? Are you aware and trying to...
Not right now, but, you know, every new gadget that comes along is exciting for us. So
you know, 10 years from now, like whatever this wild stuff is out, you know, we'll try and be on the cutting edge of that. But
try 1 year.
I think like VR's at that sweet spot of consumer stuff that we can make stuff for it right now and ship it to people. And I think Tango is, you know, maybe a year away. Or I was hoping the Google Pixel would have like the Tango phones, the camera suite. It doesn't. But soon. We're going to play with AR soon, I'm sure.
I think they're rolling it out now.
Okay, I have a question. The limitation, the 320 resolution limitation, is that software or hardware driven?
It's hardware.
Hardware.
It's just that the nature of like when you take the 1080p screen and fill it up to expand like this field of view. If you take a piece of that that's the size of, you know, a monitor on a desk, it ends up being like around that kind of resolution. So if you imagine you're sitting in a virtual room, and you have like a virtual monitor, it's the same size as a desktop PC monitor. The amount of pixels that you know space is taking up in your VR headset is 300-400 pixels width.
So do you see that improving?
It will improve. Absolutely. I think John Carmack said that the level at which it becomes indistinguishable is something like 8K screens per eye. So that's maybe 7 to 9 years away. Yeah. And then, you know, it's an exponential increase in rendering power requirements. So the video cards have to get much better and they have to get much smaller, much cheaper as well. So I think within 10 years, the screen quality will be indistinguishable from, you know, real world. Four? I hope he's right.
I know people are working on 8K right now.
Yes. Oh, I think it'll be here much earlier for like high-end devices.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Hello. I wondered if you've heard of any solutions or maybe are exploring solutions about gameplay in situations where the player doesn't have a big range of movement, either where they really have to stand in the same place or maybe in places they can do sitting down, mostly in cases of, you know, taking motion sickness into effect. Like maybe, I know there are a couple of the case studies you showed where they take out like the ceiling or the floor. So, space about depth perception and such. I'm wondering, like, what are your thoughts on that? And I'm aware of, like, people are trying to develop games and stuff that the player stays stationary in the real world. Is that really interacting with the VR world?
It's really hard because being trapped in a room gets, like, boring really fast. Like, it feels very confining. And a couple of games that do have you stationary, like, you really feel it unless they've taken, like, a lot of special care to make it feel like you can get around. But our solution was that we have a limited kind of teleport system where there's like fixed points so that there's an enormous space, but really the only places you can go are very, very, very small, you know. But despite that, it kind of feels like you're in a big place, even though it's because the relevant things are only in very specific places. So by making the rest just be there, but it not feel of interest to you, I guess, it's just distraction techniques.
Right.
I know there's a game that... It all occurs in an elevator, so you kind of go up and down floors, and every time you open the door, there's like a new thing going on. I kind of want to do an experiment one day where there's kind of like a tower that you go up, you know, you like cross the room and go into a door, and it like spirals in the virtual world, but you're just stationary, and then you kind of walk back and forth across the room, basically, but you're, you know, in the game, you're going kind of up a tower. So I think things like that might be able to make it feel like it's larger.
Jesse over here, I'm over here to your right, sorry. And you mentioned at the beginning that it seems like developing for games is a good way to solve some of these problems and then it could be potentially applied to other areas. I'm really interested in how VR could become more mainstream, more accessible to the masses. And so like one idea was, you know, coming up with the world's first VR protest where someone could just download an app, show up in a Central Park virtual space, you know, with an avatar and have a bubble that pops up like their sign. And, you know, people from all over the world could show up. You know, how far away are we from doing something like that? Sure, we won't be able to walk around, interact, tap people on the shoulder, have live conversations yet, but do you...
Just for showing up, like, in VR, like...
You
know, I mean, I think once you're at the point where, like, it's like your phone, right? Like, you just have it all the time, and you just pull it out, like, constantly all day. I guess that's when consumer VR is really hit, right? When you're just like
you know, I don't know what the form factor will be, like flipping it down or like turning it on and off, like just throughout your day persistently. When it's in that state, you know, I think a billion people will show up in a virtual event immediately because it's so effortless. But like right now, you could probably get like hundreds of people if you expand it, you know, so that it's seamless, so that even someone on a PC can participate in the 3D world. People in VR can see them, you know, a floating PC or something in that space. I think it helps bridge that gap, like until the VR spreads out. But you know, it's a challenge of a niche market right now, basically, to assemble huge amounts of people. But there's, you know, there's like 5 million VR headsets out there. There's like 3 or 4 million VR mobile VR, and like, you know, a million of the high end headsets. So it's not tiny, but definitely not large in the scope of other, you know, mobile products or whatever.
Jorge here. I've been playing a lot with the VR, especially the Vive, but now that you mentioned we're talking about the protest, I was wondering if you know about any multiplayer, probably in-room or out-of-room, but the multiplayer experiences.
I think the one that has the most like interest and momentum right now is it's a Vive game called Rec Room, where it's basically just a hangout space. We just kind of do stupid stuff. Dodgeball and play instruments and wear hats. And this is a charming, like, Nintendo-ish style. It's, like, very approachable, you know? So, I think that's, and it's free. So, I think that's the one that probably has the most momentum. There's some other Vive games, Onward, and there's another one I forget the name of, but, you know, that's, like, a PC game, a focus shooting game. So in the current like Vive owner market, like that's kind of popular. But outside of that, I think things like Rec Room, where you could just play stupid sports games and golf and put cakes on your head. I don't know. You know, people just want to do dumb stuff, dumb versions of the stuff you do in real life in VR. You know, so it's fun about it. But yeah, I mean, we think about making a multiplayer game sometimes, but you know, we just look at the player base, and you just end up right now in a situation where people go online to play and there's no one to play against.
I know that you talked about the brain a bunch, and I was wondering if you ever worked with like neuroscientists or anything like that on your designs.
No, but not on our designs. But you mean like the future stuff? This kind of stuff?
Yeah, I'm just in you talking about it with like the waves and you know, referencing science.
Oh, I mean I have a great interest in these things. I know like Facebook research is working on stuff like that, like direct stimulation to make you feel like you're moving. There was some research that shows that there are some things we can do right now, just stimulating parts of the brain that make you just get less motion sickness. It's not that we're controlling it very clearly, but just, you know, we're in the right direction. I have personal great interest in these things, brainwave reading, but it's the consumer market for brainwave reading hardware is very, none of them are very robust right now because the amount of noise from like visible motion or like surrounding signals is many orders of magnitude larger than what we're getting through the skull. So probably have to just get implants. But I know that's a big fear, but I would like to get into that more. And I know there's a lot of people who are, I don't know, there's a lot of like future stuff going on in that direction. So I'm sure like we'll see Elon Musk or someone have some cool future announcements about that stuff at some point. And then we make cool stuff for it.
Hi, my name.
Hi, my name is. Yeah, everybody come from over here.
So. My name is Perry, and my question is: Cosmic Trip is HTC only, right?
I'm on Oculus Rift now as well.
Okay. And if you decide to get into mobile games too, which would you design first? The larger ones like the HTC and the Oculus, or would you design from the ground up, starting at mobile and then make it?
Just for ease of development, I might use a HTC Oculus, but I would, just because it's kind of a smoother workflow than getting it running on a phone. But I would definitely like very, very strongly like every design decision will be focused on the mobile limitations if I was making it around that. We thought about Cosmic Trip on mobile VR, but until there's positional tracking of the controllers, it just wouldn't feel good enough. You know, there's too many edge cases of like you drop something on the ground, and it's like you're kind of trying to move your hand around. It's not
because I'm moving up and down, but it's like you can change the angle of it. But the Google Daydream has a lot of very interesting demos where, because it just has rotation, right? So you could, doing it here is exactly the same as doing it here. And they've found a lot of interesting tricks that work surprisingly well for controlling stuff in the world, but because our game is not really built around those exact ways of controlling, it's, we could kind of give someone a bad experience on mobile, or just none at all. So I've designed ground up for mobile, but just for practicality, maybe test on PC with PCDR.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Oh, okay. I do actually have a question. Okay, some of us who want to get into VR technology, where can they go to actually test VR, or does your facility offer any kind of testing or demos, or do you know anywhere where we can actually get one and actually experience it for ourselves, for some of us who want to like dabble in it or just get our feet wet?
That's a good question. I don't have any good answers because early on, Valve and Oculus were very aggressively sending developers headsets. So if you were just working on something, they would likely, if you had a demo of anything, they would likely send you a headset. But now that they're like, kind of readily available to purchase, I don't know if they're as eagerly sending them out. If you're working on something that's of special interest, so maybe like, I don't know, involved with climate change or some other like non-profit, like for good kind of activity, then they might send you one or help you out in some way. I think some stores that sell electronics have them set up. I don't know. I haven't really been around enough to see them, but I hear about them. Probably you could just put ads on Craigslist and just say, I want to try out a buy if anyone got one, give me $10.
I have a question, Bill here. Other than the initial experience where VR was really kind of cool, I haven't really seen great experiences, either gaming or experiential type things. Can you give me three or four things that you think kind of have a good wow factor and are satisfying for you?
That's tough. There's like two kind of main things that are like good, that kind of take the things to the next level, right? One is that you can come back to it over and over and over again, even if it's for a very short time. And for me, the only thing that's really done that is a game called Zenblade, where you just cut fruit. It's like Fruit Ninja, but you don't know. It's basically Fruit Ninja. I don't know, it was just relaxing, you know, you just stand there and like the fruit fly at you and you cut them and it just feels relaxing and satisfying to come back to, but I wouldn't play for more than 10 minutes at a time. But then there's the other area where like maybe like you want a deeper experience where you play it for like 2.5 hours straight, you know, and you get really into a sort of real high quality story and like emotional experience or like complicated gameplay. I hear that Raw Data is very good, because they're very like high quality production. But for me, probably the only thing that's had that experience was playing Minecraft. And it was probably because it was social, because three of us were in the same physical room and in the same Minecraft world. So it was kind of get confusing, you know, where people were. But just that social experience of like exploring Minecraft in VR, which is a terrifying game in VR, actually, because everything's kind of enormous. Yeah, that's about all the experience right now.
I have an answer for you and a question for you. The answer is IMAX, the company behind the big screen projectors.
Oh, yeah.
They're getting into IMAX, and they have a VR experience center near the Museum of Art. So go to imaxvr.com. It's a couple of tens of dollars for a 45-minute session, one of their licensed games, so the one that caught my eye was it just Star Wars experience. So you can look that up and you go come and tell us how it is.
All right.
The question for you here is, earlier you're talking about if you have a motion in a certain direction, the magnitude changing, does it increase the frame rate, except that if you do a sideways step. And then I heard him that on the very final slide here, you say, no sideways movement. So what were you referring there versus what you were talking about earlier? Yeah, avoid sideways. What is that there?
Okay, you know, when you're kind of watching a train go by, and sometimes like it's like your brain doesn't know which is the stationary moving object, and you're not really in control of it, right? You're just kind of like glancing in this sideways motion, and you think that your train is moving and the other one's stationary, or the opposite way around, you know, there's that confusion that happens, or in a car or something can happen as well. For whatever reason, I find that kind of thing happens a lot with things to the, like, 90 degrees from the actual direction of motion. So if you step into our teleporter while looking sideways, like, sometimes that can make you sick. Because as you're flying past, if your eye just happens to catch, like, a rock, and you subconsciously, like, make that your frame of reference for, like, stabilizing the world around you, which you're really not in control of, like, at all, then you'll kind of get some motion sickness. Or you can. But in practice, I've never seen anyone actually do it. And that's why we like that, like, stepping in, because you're really, like, not going to look to the side. Like, 99.99% of the time, unless you're trying to do something silly.
So you're talking about lateral movement.
Yeah. Because I don't think you're really in control of what your brain picks as, like, its reference point. And so when you have a lot of, when the motion is like, 90 degrees sideways motion is like the most decoupled you could possibly be from your direction of facing, right? The dot is like zero.
Thank you, Kevin. That was great. Thank you so much for being here.